Hello, country crooners and the motherfucking shore patrol and all the ships at sea, and welcome to A Very Good Year, the movie podcast where we invite a guest to pick their favorite year of movies and talk to us about that year. I'm your host, Jason Bailey, and across the mic and across the country from me is my co-host,
Michael Hull.
And our guest today, folks, this is he's one half of one of our very favorite podcasts. And really, if you listen to both, one of the clear models for this show. And that's the Pure Cinema Podcast. Subscribe if you somehow don't already. You won't be disappointed. He also hosts the wonderful Just the Discs podcast, which is on YouTube and wherever fine podcasts are caught. Please join us in welcoming the charming, the knowledgeable Mr. Brian Saur. Hi, Brian.
Hello, sir. Very kind. Great to be here. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you for coming on. And thank you for the shout outs you've given us elsewhere, which means so much and helps a struggling little program like ours.
It's a pleasure. And it's a great format. It's a great idea. And it's my movie brain just automatically goes crazy in a good way when I see anything that will allow me to separate movies into a certain group and then figure out where to put them. And so by year is a great way to go. And I think it's a really neat format.
Well, thank you. That really does mean a lot. Okay, so let me start with the question I always ask to classic film lovers who come on the show, which is, what was your kind of entry point? When did you make that transition between the sort of the casual moviegoer and the person whose brain works in the way that you just mentioned? and what brought that on?
Well, I will say the brain stuff has come more recently within the last decade or so, and when it came to podcasting, because that really was something I needed for the podcasting. It sort of developed into a muscle that I have now for that. But in terms of, you know, finding my way into cinema seriously, I would say probably started around college-ish. Well, maybe a little before, because I had some video store jobs in high school. One of my first real jobs was at a Blockbuster franchise when I was in high school. And then I took that and I went to UW-Madison, where we also had a State Street Blockbuster location. So then I worked there through my entire college years, and then actually a couple years after college before we moved to California. So it was the video store thing started the things going, but then when I got into college and started taking film classes and discovering the books of Danny Perry, the cult movies books and Guide for the Film Fanatic, my favorite book, I think that's when it really clicked into seriousness. And it became a thing where, oh, he's got it right there. Look at that. Love it. Love it. I got the tattoo, man. I got the tattoo. So it was around then that I think I started to really get into cult movies, which led me down a certain path. And that's been one of the main paths in my life, is cult film, classic film. And then some classes I took. I remember I took a Western class that really got me into Westerns, and that just really started to expand and blossom from there, I think. So when I was in my middle 20s, I would say, is when it really started.
So on the off chance that we have anyone listening who doesn't listen to your show, and it seems incredibly unlikely, but just in case, tell us just sort of the short version of what Pure Cinema Podcast is and kind of what the title means in relation to that, which is one of the things I like about the show.
Well, the title comes from a quote from my partner, Elric Kane. He just used to say that all the time on his podcasts, and it was just something that seemed appropriate. I'll admit it's a little highfalutin, but it's just one of those things where he and I are just really into it, like down to our DNA. So on some level, I don't apologize for it. But in terms of what it is, I mean, Elric Kane and I became friends through his podcasting. He's had many shows over the years, horror-related shows, and I became a fan and started to talk to him about movies that weren't horror. And he would do some discoveries lists for an old blog I used to run. And I started to realize we had a lot more in common in terms of that. And then we did an interview for a documentary I was working on about Danny Perry. And it really clicked. Like, we just had a conversation and he reached out to me and said, hey, you know, would you ever want to do a show? And we worked out what it might be. And it's really, it's evolved some over the years, but really one of the guiding principles is, you know, something we got from Danny Perry, which is, you know, there's no high and low art as much as there's just stuff that you, that gets you. And so we have something on the show we call Five Films Because, and that is because we didn't want to get pigeonholed into a top five format per se, because you can always get people coming at you about, what about this? What about that?
Right. Right.
And we just kind of wanted to undercut that. And also we wanted to just be able to talk about what we wanted to talk about. So right. Five Films Because is just, we bring to any topic we might be doing, five movies we'd like to discuss. They may not all be masterpieces, but there's things about them we find interesting and compelling, and we want to talk about them. So I find that pretty freeing to not have to think about what's the absolute best thing ever. Another focus of the show is discoveries. We're always trying to find new movies.
Yep.
We just dropped our big film discoveries of 2023 episode, which yes. is our favorite to do, and it's so much fun to dig in and really find some stuff, sometimes obscure stuff, to talk about that really impacted us over the year. The other thing we do is we do director's episodes where we'll highlight, we did a two-parter of William Friedkin, but one of the other things that we do on the show is we pair movies. So, we call it sort of a video store for your ears. A lot of it is about, like, the conversations you might have with somebody behind the counter in the video store right. back in the days. And this sort of, if you like this, you'll like this. That's what pairings is about. So we talked about five classic, in this case, films from Friedkin, and then five films because. And we paired each one with another film to kind of offer a, you know, a little something else to go with it, but also give some people an idea of what kind of movie it is. Maybe you don't know that movie, but you know the paired movie. You know, it's just a way in and another way to talk about other movies. So those are the main things we do on the show. And we also do a rundown of the New Beverly calendar. We're the official podcast of the New Beverly Cinema here in Los Angeles, a great rep theater, one of yep. the best in the world. And we're honored to go through their calendar every month. That's always a blast too.
Yeah. No, it really is a wonderful podcast. And, you know, I giggle at the idea that the idea of pure cinema is somehow highfalutin, because you guys certainly don't apply it in those ways. And one of the things that I love about your show is it really has sort of changed the way that I approach older films, because so often it's about, okay, well, you know, this isn't a masterpiece, but here's this thing that's going on in it that's really interesting. Or here's this set piece that will just knock your socks off. And, you know, the idea of plumbing the history and finding these little performances or moments or things that are of note, and appreciating the picture for that, it really does sort of rewire your brain, especially when you're a critic who has to look at these things every day. I look at this stuff in a different way, and I attribute a lot of that to you guys and to listening to your show as faithfully as I do.
Well, that's a true honor to hear that.
I really love the New Beverly shows, the New Beverly yeah. episodes, but I end up tuning out of like half of those just out of pure jealousy that I can't just immediately
FOMO
go
is
and
a
see
bitch.
Them. It's just, I mean, I just like the 30 minutes in, I'm just like, all right, I can't take it anymore. I can't take it anymore.
I totally get it. Like, it's tough. And there is a part of those shows that we always wonder about what the broad appeal is. Although we do have a lot of people who listen outside yeah. of LA, because it is fun to talk about those movies. And Phil, who programs there and is our co-host on those shows, he always encourages people to follow along at home. So we're trying to be inclusive, but on that level, it is tough to be like, you're not going to be able to see this. Sorry. You know, that's yeah.
I mean, that's
bummer.
The thing. Even when I've seen the movies, I haven't seen them with Phil. You know, that's the like, right?
That's a different thing, man. It's a different thing.
All right. So what year did you pick to talk about today and why?
It was tough, especially when you told me that the slate was basically clear and I yeah. could almost pick anything. I will admit that was a little overwhelming at first, because I was like, oh, I started looking back through old shows. I'm like, okay, there's one that's, okay, what are they? And then when you told me you were starting over for this season, I was like, uh-oh, okay. So basically what I did was I went back to like a big list I have on Letterboxd of some of my all-time favorites, and I just started to sort of, in a circular way, sketch around certain movies. And I'll tell you, there's one specific one in this list. It's actually not my number one. It's my number two, that I was like, I want to talk about this year because of this movie. And then I started just sort of, you know, branching out, like, what else is in this year that I like? Mm-hmm. And one of the things I recommend people do using Letterboxd is there's so many great people who create lists on Letterboxd of just thousands of different ideas and kinds of movies. But yeah. let's say, you know, for instance, I brought up the Guide for the Film Fanatic. There's at least two lists that include the entire, I don't know, like 1,500 some movies from the Guide for the Film Fanatic. So one thing you can do is you can separate those lists by decade. You can separate them by specific year. So then I just sort of went to like, oh, what did Danny talk about in 1973, for instance? And I was like, oh yeah, okay. And so I just started to put things together. I watched a few things, and 1973 just ended up being the one that really had enough for me to talk about that hadn't been talked about on the previous episode. And so I was like, okay, yeah, this might be the one. And yeah, there's just a lot of really great movies in the 70s in general, but this year was, I don't know, there's quite a few also rans that didn't mm-hmm. make the list. It was just too strong a group to ignore ultimately.
Yeah. I love the description of the process, Brian. I just picture you with like a giant like whiteboard and, you know, thumbtacks and string, and it's a whole homeland situation. Okay, so before we get to your very good top five list, Mike is going to take us on a quick walk through what was going on in the news in 73. Here's headlines.
Nice.
This is a new season. I should get a newscaster voice.
Maybe.
Maybe I should get a newscaster voice. 1973, it was a hard year for most people. Something of that. Like, I feel like that. United Press International.
There you go.
I love
year
it.
In review. It was a tough year. It was really dominated by Nixon and mm-hmm. all of that sort of falling apart and all of that thing that we know. He signed the Paris Peace Accords and we started leaving Vietnam. So that was great. But Watergate was on its way. Everything was terrible. OPEC members announced that they were going to start restricting the flow of crude oil, and Richard Nixon asked people to stop buying gasoline between Saturday night and Monday morning.
Mm-hmm.
And America said, I know it's expensive, but can I get some? Roe v. Wade was 1973. So, I mean, are we going to do, like, I feel like it's impossible not to do the we settled that joke, even though I feel like, you know, we already did the we settled that joke, right?
We did. Yes.
Another big event in 1973 was Wounded Knee. About 200 Oglala Lakota Native Americans and members of the American Indian Movement began their occupation of Wounded Knee in South Dakota in February of 1973. And that is a big story that actually should have way more movies about it.
Yep.
Right? Like, at what point does, like, the Res Dogs team get to start making, like, dramas?
There we go.
You know, because that's going to be a big one. Vice President Agnew resigned. Should we make a list of the things that Vice President Agnew did before he had to resign?
I think you can just, like, put in a ding sound effect after you say each of them.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yep. Vice President Spiro Agnew resigned on October 10th while under investigation for criminal conspiracy, bribery, extortion, and tax fraud, all of which he was extremely guilty of and had used his office to further his criminal gains. Can you imagine how guilty he was to have quit? Like, Vice President, you don't have anything to do but be corrupt.
Yeah.
Anyway, maybe he was the best vice president ever. Hot take, Spiro Agnew, best vice president ever. He really used his time. One of the few political scandals of the era that Spiro was not involved in was Watergate, which escalated throughout 73. Highlights included former White House aide Alexander Butterfield's July disclosure that President Nixon had used an Oval Office recording system to tape record potentially incriminating conversations. In sports, the Dolphins built the DC team with the racist name to win the Super Bowl. The Knicks beat the Lakers 4-1. The Oakland Athletics beat the New York Mets 4-3 to win the World Series. And George Foreman defeated Joe Frazier to win the World Heavyweight Championship in the so-called Sunshine Showdown in Kingston, Jamaica. That is not as well known. That is not the most mm-hmm. well known of the boxing names from the 70s, the Sunshine Showdown. That sounds more like if Bob Marley did the soundtrack for a Clint Eastwood movie or a Sergio Leone movie, even better. It would be called Sunshine Showdown.
Yeah.
Foreman would be the champ for two more bouts before facing Ali in the Rumble in the Jungle, and we all know what happened there. That's sports and that's headlines.
All right, thank you, Mike. Brian Saur, are you ready to do a top five?
I'm ready.
All right, so we're doing a ranked list, which we always enjoy. Take a stand, stake it out, and make it. So what then, Brian, is your number five movie for 1973?
Oh, I should just say at the top. I mean, the rank is there, but there's not a lot. I love all these movies, so it's not to say that there's like, this is that much better than this.
Yes.
It's just, anyway, I'm going to start with Herbert Ross's The Last of Sheila.
That was the last of Sheila. That was what they thought anyway. Until they started playing Sheila's game. Tom thought he could beat the game.
Don't touch.
Christine played for the prize.
Get him! Get me a glass of water and a couple of
lesbians. Clinton was the master of the game.
I call it the Sheila Green Memorial Gossip Game.
And this one, I think, has been made a little more prominent by the fact that Rian Johnson's definitely a fan. He's talked about it, actually, even on our show back when we had him on when Knives Out came out.
Yeah, good episode.
He was so much fun, man. Talk about a great guy. And I would say it's even more influential on Glass Onion. If you look at Glass Onion and that and this movie, you're going to see that there's definitely some similarities. But it's a really great whodunit with like just an incredible cast of, you know, it 70s actors. But I should say at the top, one thing that's really interesting is it's written by Stephen Sondheim and Anthony Perkins. And apparently they were both, but Sondheim especially, really big fans of, you know, whodunit games. And I guess as early as the 60s, you know, Sondheim was doing sort of, you know, whodunit kind of mysteries with folks he knew, and it sort of ended up parlaying into this screenplay sort of somehow. And anyway, they're really good because they put together a great whodunit with
it's a great script. Like, it's a really smart, funny, tight script, like that you would think that you would think was the work of some seasoned screenwriter, as opposed to just sort of a couple of guys who were moonlighting, kind of.
Absolutely. It's one of my, among my favorite scripts of the 70s. I think it's really, really strong. But just to give the idea, basically you have, we open on some kind of a party being thrown by a producer, played by James Coburn, and a woman is hit by a car. We don't know the significance of that. Cut to, some time later, we see a bunch of people who will be the players in this story, that are getting invited to this get together on his yacht. Again, this is where the Glass Onion parallel really starts to line up.
Right.
The people you have in this piece are the Clinton Green, that's James Coburn, he's the producer. His guests are Alice Wood, she's an actor, played by Raquel Welch, and her talent manager husband, Anthony Wood, played by a very young Ian McShane. You have a secretary turned talent agent, Christine, played by Diane Cannon, who is an awful person, but gosh, she plays it really well.
Yeah, she does.
And then you have a screenwriter, Tom Parkman, played by the great Richard Benjamin, and his wife, Lee, played by Joan Hackett, as well as a film director, Philip Dexter, played by James Mason. And so this trip, they're getting together to go on this wonderful yacht called the Sheila, and they, Clinton turns it into a game. Basically, he gives everybody a card with a bit of a secret about somebody, and he basically will go in. They'll stop in little ports along the way, and they'll have like a little mystery to solve in each of the ports, and it becomes more and more intense. And I don't really want to give away too much more than that, honestly. I really think the where the game goes and the last hour of the movie. I forgot like how early one of the big things happens and sort of sets the last hour into motion. And that's really great. But again, very clever script, smart characters, self-aware characters, you know, just really, really well played. But the James Coburn character is such a son of a bitch and is so mean to every single person on this trip. He's just an asshole and he really owns it. But everybody's great, really great in this. And just a wonderful whodunit. Again, one of my favorite sort of whodunits of the 70s. And Just love it. Just absolutely love the movie. So I wanted to get like sort of different kinds of movies. I think that was the other reason to pick 73 is I was finding like, oh, I can do different kinds of things. Here's a whodunit to start it off, you know?
Right, right, right. Yeah, well, I mean, and I think what's sort of terrific about it too is that there's such a lightness to it, and to the way that it, the sort of sophistication of it and the way that it mixes the mystery and the comedy. And it really reminded me, and I wasn't thinking of this the first time I saw it, but when we were having you on, I know how much you love the Thin Man movies.
I love
them. And this movie feels in many ways the way that those do. It has that very, that lightness, that sort of, you know, offhand comedy, the slight drunkenness. I would be very surprised if they weren't looking at this one, at those movies as sort of an inspiration for this one as well. Tell me a little bit about Herbert Ross, because he directed this, and he's not someone we talk about a lot, but his name is on a lot of significant movies.
Agreed.
In this.
Yeah, year. He's a guy I think gets a little underrated for sure. I think the first one I came across from him was Play It Again, Sam. But mm-hmm. even this year, I'm discovering things from him. Fun City Editions put out T.R. Baskin, which I thought was great.
Which is
really
great.
Good movie. Yeah. But I mean, he's a yeah. guy who is really, he's done so much stuff that I think people really overlook him. I maybe it's partially because I don't want to say he's not a stylist, but he is a very functional filmmaker that doesn't yes. get in the way of the storytelling. And that's yeah. that's meant as the highest compliment I can give him. But I mean, he's done comedies. He's done like the 7% Solution is a great Sherlock Holmes movie. Mm-hmm. And then you get into the 80s yeah. and he's doing like My Blue Heaven and Secret of My Success and Footloose, of course, and Pennies from Heaven. I mean, he's just really an interesting guy.
I think a lot of the times, especially in the 70s, you know, he was working so often with people like Neil Simon, who had such a strong voice as a screenwriter, that in that kind of auteurist era, he might have sort of been dismissed as kind of a journeyman, which he was, but I think in a good way. I think his is always a name that I pay attention to when it comes up in those.
Yeah, comments. Absolutely. Especially after I think I saw Last of Sheila for the first time in about 2012. And that's when it really like mm-hmm. locked in for me, like, oh, I need to pay attention to him because this is such a well-made yeah. film. You know, it's a great script, yeah. but it's a really well-made and well-cast film. So he's good with cat. I feel like Agreed. He's good with casting too.
All right. So Brian, then what is your number four pick for 1973?
Okay. My number four. And by the way, all of these have been talked about on Pure Cinema at one point or another. These are movies that we really like a lot. And anyway, so this is a big one for Elric and I. It is Scarecrow from 1973, of course. I'm used to saying years on Pure Cinema. It's not necessary here.
Behold, the captains of industry, the prospective owners of Maxie's Car Wash, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
You mean Maxie's Car Wash?
Car Wash?
Yeah.
Okay.
For every car, there is dirt.
Max and Lion. The only difference between them and the Rockefellers is a few hundred million dollars and about 1,500 miles.
This one, really something. From director Jerry Schatzberg, who, another name that a lot of people don't know, but a guy who made a ton of great movies, including The Panic in Needle Park, which preceded this one, and was really something, and a big breakout for Pacino. In fact, I'm pretty sure I heard that Coppola saw him in Panic and was like, I need to get him for The Godfather. Yep. This movie is really special. It is a road movie with Gene Hackman and Al Pacino. As far as I know, I don't think they did another movie together, but there may be something I'm forgetting. Nope. But it is shot by Vilmos Zsigmond in widescreen. It's beautiful. There's a Warner Archive Blu-ray you can check out. And it's about two drifters, basically, who are bumming their way across the country trying to get to Pittsburgh because the Gene Hackman character, Max, he has dreams of opening a car wash. And Pacino's character, Francis Lionel Delbucchi, goes by Lion. They meet each other in a really great opening. One of my among my favorite openings of a 70s movie is them, they're basically on the opposite sides of this barren highway, and Gene Hackman sort of crawls in, gets hung up on a barbed wire fence, and ends up at the edge of the road, and Pacino's character is there, and, you know, Hackman's character, we find out he was in the joint. He is, you know, he's got some money, but he's got to find his way across. He really is a grouch, doesn't really trust or want to talk to anybody, and definitely does not want to talk to the lion character. But they, there's a great sort of meet cute in the way that the Pacino character sort of breaks the ice, and ultimately they end up connecting. But they're just great together. They're two very different kinds of characters. The lion character is very much a guy who believes in disarming people with humor. And the title of the film, I won't spoil, but it comes from one of his big observations about scarecrows. And they are just so good together in this.
Whether it's fair or not, like, you think of those guys at that era in French Connection, Serpico. You know, like, you think about, like, obviously Godfather.
Ferocious.
You know, there's like, there's a handful of movies that really define those guys at that time. And because they were so good and so, you know, they've become so classic. And these characters in this movie that came out in the same time as all those other movies you think about. And even in that description that you're giving of Hackman's character, sounds like a lot of other characters he played. This is nothing like any other movies they were in that time or other times, not like any other characters they played. I mean, even, you know, the scene, because they get locked up and there's, you know, things seem to be going well for the Pacino character initially, and then things go very, very badly for him at some point. And the way he played that was so different. I mean, you know, it was so different than Needle Park, than Hustlers, than, you know, let alone not to even get anywhere near The Godfather, right? That defining thing. I just, like, I sat down sort of without meaning to, expecting some sort of French Connection, Panic in Needle Park, you know, combo thing. And that was not what I was served.
Not at all.
Not at all. It was really surprising and really great.
It's a modest movie.
Oh, that's a good point. But Mike, you make a really good point. They really don't, these guys don't play characters like this maybe ever again, really. And I hadn't thought about that specifically. But especially in the context of French Connection, Serpico, Godfather, it's so much different than that.
It's so 73 too. Like, the dream is to get to Pittsburgh and open a car wash. I was just like, man, we're really marinating. We're really taking a bath in 1973 with this movie.
Yeah. It's just something that the way that it meanders through, and we run into some great character actors like Eileen Brennan. And speaking of lockup, I mean, one thing you never do is you never trust Richard Lynch. That's just not a good idea. You know, that'll always get you in trouble. So yeah, he's great. He shows up.
Yeah.
But I love that the movie really at its core is about friendship and how strong those bonds can be. And it's incredibly moving. I will say, just a it's not a spoiler, but there's a sort of a darker turn in the back part of the movie. But it really solidifies the friendship in a way. And I just love that about it. It's just an incredible film, and one that seems to be relatively well logged on Letterboxd. I do use Letterboxd a lot as a gauge for how many people have, you know, seen this recently. You know, and it seems like some people have seen it. I think it was streaming on HBO Max for a while. It's not anymore, unfortunately, but you can stream it just about anywhere if you want. But yeah, just a great, great movie with two of our greatest actors together for the first and only time. So really something special.
Brian Saur, what is the number three movie on your top five for 73?
Number three is Save the Tiger.
First the Buffalo went, then the Indian went, then the Brooklyn Dodgers. Now, Harry Stoner is the last of an endangered species.
Harry, we're going to have a talk.
It's a criminal act, Harry.
You screamed in your sleep. That's the second time this week.
Arson, Harry. Arson. This is a major felony. But you're talking
arson,
about
20
all
years.
It is the same accommodation.
It's a criminal act, Harry.
Harry, tell me, what do you want? Another season.
Jack Lemmon in Save the Tiger. Rated R.
Starring Jack Lemmon in maybe his best performance, one of my favorites, directed by John G. Avildsen, who would go on to do Rocky. But I got to tell you, I like this movie more than I like Rocky, if I'm being completely honest.
There
this
we go.
Movie is One of a genre that I think Elric and I both find ourselves drawn to these days, and it's kind of like a midlife crisis movie in some sense.
Yeah.
But it's just a great story with a really good supporting cast. One of the main supporting characters that I love is Jack Guilford, who's a guy so good and does not get nearly enough praise for the amount. He's in They Might Be Giants, and I love him in that movie too. But Lemon plays Harry Stoner, and he is a guy who runs a textile clothing manufacturing sort of company, shop, warehouse. And he's having a really tricky day on this particular day. Mm-hmm. But one thing I love about the movie is it's one of those that opens like showing him wake up. You see him talking to his wife. She's going away. You know, you get a sense of their relationship, their physical relationship, which maybe is lacking. And then he goes off and picks up some hippie girl on the way to the office. And that comes into play later and finds his way into Jack Guilford, who's his accountant. And we find that there is a couple things going on. One, they're about to do their big annual show, which is where all the orders get placed. And that's how they get a lot of their money. But he's struggling with they owe a bunch of money and they probably can't make it up. And they end up coming to the conclusion that maybe they have to do a little something very extreme, getting an arsonist involved to maybe deal with getting some insurance money to help them. And Jack Guilford's character is not happy about that. But there's a lot of stuff happening. There's a new client in town that needs a hooker and just all kinds of crazy things that he's juggling. But there's something about this character that is so moving to me, the point he's at in his life, the wistful nature that he has in certain moments, the PTSD he's dealing with that comes out in some awkward ways. It's just Powerhouse doesn't really cover it. It's just something else in terms of this performance. Yeah. But it's sort of like a day in his life. And I just love a very 70s feeling movie and a movie that I think didn't have a huge budget, was definitely a passion project for many involved, and you can feel that. But like I said, Jack Lemmon, one of my favorite actors of all time. I love The Apartment. I love so many of his performances, but this one at where I am right now is one that just absolutely sings to me, and I can't get it out of my head when I'm still thinking about it. And I think, Jason, you might have watched it for the first time. Is that right?
You know, here's the thing. You talked about this phenomenon fairly recently. I want to say on your last bonus episode, that thing where like you spend years going, "Oh yeah, I've seen that."
Oh yeah, all the time.
And you're just sure that like, you know, in your 20s or something, you took it home from the video store one night or whatever. And I was dead ass that I had seen Save the Tiger to an extent that I think I didn't go back to listen because I'm going to be embarrassed if I did. I think I even dinged this Oscar win in the last 1973 show. And I put it on just sort of as a refresher. And yeah, it's that thing you talked about, like 5 minutes. I'm like, nope, I've never fucking seen
this.
Happens
to me all the time.
It's great. It's a great performance. It is not to be sort of dismissed as like, oh, well, you know, they gave it to the lesser of, you know, of all of these iconic performances. It's a terrific piece of work. I think one, you know, I'm a huge Glengarry Glen Ross guy, and this I think would be really interesting to watch on a double with Glengarry because this very much feels like the first part of that Lemon performance in Glengarry Glen Ross, like when it was all starting to go south for that guy.
I like that.
It's a great, it's a really terrific performance. And also, you know, when we mention John G. Avildsen, like, you know, the go-to is Rocky, obviously. That's one of the iconic American movies. I think this movie is happening in a more interesting conversation with the movie he made right before it, which is Joe.
That's true.
Which we've talked about on the other podcast, that this feels very much of a piece with the non-Joe stuff in Joe, with the, you know, sort of frustrated businessman generation gap stuff. Especially in the scenes with the hippie chick, where she gets in the car and asks him if he wants to ball. And I'm sorry, you know, can we bring back ball? Like, I think we're all tired of the sexual euphemisms of our present day. I think ball is positioned for a comeback.
I'm with you.
I think we're all ready for it. All right, great. But yeah, Save the Tiger, fantastic piece of work, really moving, and Lemon just fucking owning it. All right, Brian, what is your number two movie for 1973?
Okay, my number two, the ground zero for this list. One yes. of my very favorites, and it's a tough movie in a lot of ways, but I sometimes struggle with tough movies as favorites because you don't always want to come back to them, but there's something about this tough movie that allows me to come back. I think there's enough comedy in it mixed in with the drama and the sadness that it allows me to come back in. Anyway, the movie is Payday.
Meet Maury Dan.
He's a star, honey.
I don't hang around Nashville waiting for Johnny Cash.
He's getting along all right. She's a country girl.
He wants a piece of the gate next time out.
People in hell want ice water, too.
He gets the best things in life.
We only pass this way once. Might as well pass by in a Cadillac.
It is a very special movie to me in a lot of ways. One factor is that it's one of the first movies I remember seeing at the Egyptian Theater here in Los Angeles when I moved to California circa 99 or 2000. Roommate and I went to see it on a double bill with Cisco Pike, which is another movie considered for another year list because that's a great, great
wow.
movie.
Yeah.
But at the time, these movies were...
That's a good pairing. That's a really good pairing.
Truly one of my favorite double bills I've ever seen. Let alone recently. But it was, those were so rare at the time. And now you can get, you know, at least a DVD of this and a Blu-ray of Cisco Pike. But back then you couldn't see them at all. And this movie just floored me. The basic premise is that you have Rip Torn talk about another virtuoso. I think he's pretty much said this is his favorite of everything he's done. He plays Maury Dan, who is a country singer, I would say second rate, sort of a almost made it, but never really made it kind of country singer.
Yeah.
And we are with him for about 36 hours. And so we're getting a look at sort of behind the scenes of him touring the honky tonks and the other things he's dealing with, in the South. And he is just a real, talk about a piece of shit. but one of the most charismatic pieces of shit in cinema, I think, because he just owns it. So we open with him and his band singing at this little divey place, and you know we get to see him. He did his own singing. He sort of talk sings his way through it, but he's
totally convincing.
He pulls it off. It's a great. It's such a great character. He's so confident and so fakely humble when he needs to be, and he's just incredible in this character. Just doing awful things to women in this. There's multiple, you know, there's a scene where he's having sex with a woman he's brought along in his stretch limo with his girlfriend in the car asleep, you know, like that's the kind of thing we're dealing with, this kind of guy.
Yeah.
But I mean, the behind the scenes is all kinds of fun stuff. Like he goes bird shooting one day and gets in a fight with one of his band members about his mom not caring for his dog. Oh, and his mom, he's her drug dealer. You know, like just shit like that. And then kowtowing to local DJs who like definitely don't care for him.
God, I love that scene.
That's a great scene. And then, you know, meeting some young kid who sees him at a restaurant, you know, where he gets called out by somebody that, I won't go into the specifics. I'm giving away the whole plot here. But there's just so much great stuff in this behind the scenes of this guy's life. And it has a really impactful ending. I love what he brings to this character. He really just absolutely lives in this guy. And it's just a remarkable film. Another one that I can't stop talking about. There's a great Wrong Reel podcast episode where they talk all about this one. But two things I should note. It's directed by Daryl Duke, who's a big favorite of ours at Pure Cinema. He did The Silent Partner, and he did one of my favorite discoveries of the year was this movie called Griffin and Phoenix, which is a TV movie with Joe Clayburgh and...
And Peter Falk, Falk.
Yeah.
Oh, shit, I've seen that.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
he's good.
He's very good.
It's not a huge filmography, but everything this guy did was like worth watching.
Yeah, very solid. Tarantino likes a TV movie he did with Culp called Cry for Help. He's a really interesting guy. And the songs, just in case you didn't notice, are written by Shel Silverstein. So that's an interesting wrinkle to this movie. Nice. But yeah, it's amazing. It's just an amazing movie that really sticks with you. Jason, I saw you really liked it, so I'd love to hear your thoughts.
I mean, this is one that's been on my watch list for years, mostly because of you, because like you guys never miss an opportunity to sort of evangelize for it on Pure Cinema. And it's just, you know, I just kept meaning to get around to it. And so I finally had an excuse to watch it. It's so... And you touched on this a little bit. It's so lived in, you know, like it feels so authentic, like every detail of this life and this career feels researched and marinated, but then just sort of thrown off. And to achieve both of those things at once, I think is really difficult and incredible. And yeah, Rip Torn is just, he's amazing. Like I don't think until maybe towards the end got the credit he deserved as one of the best actors of his generation. And this is just a towering performance. I'm not sure. This one is it's still just DVD. We don't even have a Blu-ray of this one.
No,
right?
Blu-ray. Yeah, that's the tricky part. I think that's why a lot of people haven't seen it. I think there's a rip on YouTube, but yeah, the DVD is the only way physically to own it. And I'm really shocked that nobody's picked it up, but I think it's still one of those that's just a little enough under the radar that people aren't paying enough attention to it. But boy, it needs a nice Blu-ray, and I'd be first in line to pick it up if someone put it out, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, seek it out because it's worth the effort. All right, so then the number one, the one that ranked even higher than The Great Payday. What is it, Brian Saur?
Well, that is going to be the last detail. Hal Ashby's film...
What the hell did he do, kill the old man?
Robbery.
How much did he lift?
$40.
Tried to lift the polio contribution box.
Yeah?
Polio box is the old man's old lady's favorite do-gooder project. She took it very seriously.
Where are we going, Chief?
Portsmouth Naval Prison.
Good duty for you guys.
They're gonna get him there, all right. But first, they gotta take care of a few details along the way.
I mean, this is one that I also was circling around for this year, but you know, it's an all-timer for me, and it's a classic for a reason. It is Ashby on more or less on the heels of Harold and Maude, working with Robert Towne, who has yet to do Chinatown. He would do that after this. He's adapting a book, but he does a great job. It is obviously a story about two petty officers in the Navy, played by Jack Nicholson, and a really great turn from Otis Young, who I don't haven't seen in a ton of other movies. And they are assigned to take a young man, Meadows, played by a young Randy Quaid, to prison in, I want to say they're going to Portsmouth. I can't remember where they're going. Where they're coming from now. I forget. But basically, they have to run him to the prison.
Coming from Newport. Going to
Newport
Portsmouth.
To Portsmouth.
They're in the Navy. They're going from one port to another.
So these two guys are just great characters. Jack Nicholson plays, does he have a first name even? Billy, I guess is his first name. Billy Badusky, a.k.a. Badass. Yeah. And
great name.
And Otis Young plays Mule Mulhall. People just call him Mule. These two guys have never really hung out before, but they really connect in doing this project. And basically Nicholson, once they get the project or this assignment, says, okay, we're going to get this per diem. We have a week to do this. Let's just run him on up there really quick and then take his per diem and our per diem and just spend it and take our time getting back. And Mule is like, that sounds great to me. They meet the kid. They find out from the great Clifton James, great opening. He's the master at arms at the place where they're stationed, and he tells them the assignment. He's wonderful. Basically, any movie that opens with Clifton James giving a little speech, I'm in, really. And he's got some great dialogue there. But basically, you find out Randy Quaid's character is a chronic kleptomaniac. He tried to lift the polio box at the local, I guess the church or whatever they have on this base.
1973, baby, the polio box.
But the problem with that is it's $40, which you find out he didn't even get. But the bigger issue is that it is the head commander's wife's favorite charity. So he gets 8 years in a brig for this $40 non-theft. And so they kind of immediately are kind of like, ooh, that's rough. You know, that's a rough sentence for, especially for $40. So there's a little sympathy from them to start. But what we start to see as they go is that especially the Nicholson character gets more and more sympathetic to the Meadows character. And they basically start to decide, well, maybe we could take an extra little bit. Let's stop off and get some beers for him. And it's like an interesting combination of a hangout and a road movie. Two kinds of movies I really enjoy. And just really genuine feeling characters and Nicholson, and truly a big breakout. I mean, he'd already done Easy Rider. He'd already done Five Easy Pieces. But this one, I think, is like an explosion. It's just such a gregarious, noticeable character. And the other thing about the movie is that it was pretty remarkably dirty for its time.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the F word fuck is used in excess of 60 times throughout the course of this movie. And I think it's almost Jack's first line has fuck in it. It's like his second line says fuck. So there's a lot of swearing. Even in 73, I think this was a pretty extreme R-rated movie in terms of the language. I mean, they are sailors, so they're definitely trying to be accurate with that.
Literally what, that's the expression, curse like a sailor. You got to have your sailor's curse. I don't know what people were surprised by here.
Exactly. This movie lives up to that for sure. But really, for me, it's just such an incredibly, again, a movie about friendship. I think that's another thing that runs through some of these, and that was an unintentional thing.
You want to be a 26-year-old in 1973. This is what I'm figuring out.
I think you're right.
List. Like, you want to be, like, the bass player in the band. You want to be, like, you know, Mule. You want to be, like, 26, an adult but unattached. Yes. And just sort of like living in the world in 1973.
I think you're onto something there, Mike. I think you're onto something.
Who amongst us?
But yeah, it's just, I mean, among a career and even just a 70s run of incredible films, you have Ashby starts with The Landlord in 1970, then he goes to Harold and Maude, then this, then Shampoo, again with Town in 75, Bound for Glory, Coming Home, Being There. It's an incredible run. I think this is my favorite Hal Ashby movie, full stop. And it's a big one for, Alexander Payne. Definitely in watching. Another reason I thought it apt to pick this movie is The Holdovers obviously came out just late last year. One of my favorite films of the year from last year. And I felt some Last Detail in it when I watched it. And sure enough, Alexander Payne had confirmed that they even watched it before they made it. But he says, and he's all over the Blu-ray and 4K for Last Detail. He has an introduction, which is great. And he does another little conversation about it where he talks about how he watches it about once a year. And, you know, he loves Ashby. And I think he, as people have said, he emulates Ashby in his own special way. And this movie is definitely one that he's sort of channeling for The Holdovers in some ways, I think. So it's great that it's still feeling resonance now as recently as that film. I just absolutely love it. The camaraderie between the three guys that you feel throughout the course of the movie is just so compelling and so powerful. It's so goddamn funny though too. I mean, it just makes me laugh like crazy every time. So just a real gem. One of the best of the 70s for my money.
I hate to have the same comment that I made about Scarecrow, but like I grew up in the 80s. Like I think of Randy Quaid as the National Lampoon character. You know, like just my first, I don't even try to, that's just my first sort of real association with him. And he's great. And I mean, you know, Jack Nicholson's very good, but you sort of know that's going to happen.
Right.
You know, you're sort of like, wow, you're watching Otis Young play off of him. Yeah. Like this guy's really holding his own.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
But Randy Quaid is just so heartbreaking and like relatable somehow years after, you know, I don't know. Really, really blew my mind in that.
Yeah. He is fantastic in it. Agreed.
The only other thing I would add, and I think this is maybe one of the best movies to make this case for, you know, the great filmmakers of the 70s, the Scorseses, the Coppolas, you know, anybody you want to run down, I have a pretty easy time articulating what they do, what is special about them, what sort of pieces of cinema they're commanding and orchestrating in their best work. A gun to my head, I can't tell you what Ashby does. Like I've ingested all of these movies. I've seen them all more than once. I want to understand it, and I can't articulate it. There's just a specificity to his touch and to his approach to the material, the way that he lets it live and breathe on screen, while always feeling his presence somewhere near the edge of the frame. I don't know what it is that's so good about him, but this is one of the movies where it's really like, it would be so easy for this movie to go sideways. 1,000 terrible directors would have made a horrible movie out of this screenplay with this cast. And there's just something about his touch that's just right for it. And that's the closest I can come to articulating what it is.
I'm with you. He's hard to quantify. I mean, I know that part of what makes him special is he starts as an editor. And I think you can see in the filmmaking that he, you know, he knows things that beyond what a normal director would know in terms of how to put things together. And I think that has always been, especially if you think about a scene like the near the end scene in Harold and Maude, where he's cutting back and forth and it's the hospital and the other thing that's happening, that kind of stuff, you're like, that's masterful. And few people, I think, have the skill set to think about putting films together in that way. And I think that's part of it. I think the other thing is he obviously led with character all the time and really brings a very humanistic approach to character. And I think those are the only things I can really, you know, quantify about him, other than the fact that I love his stuff. He is really special in that sense. It's hard to put him in a box, you know?
Yeah, agreed. All right, Brian, this was a great top five. Thank you so much for putting it together
for us. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Let's find out just a little bit about the big doings of the movie business in the year 1973. Here is Mike with the Hollywood Minute.
Hollywood freaks on the Hollywood scene.
George Roy Hill's The Sting, which reunited the director with his Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid stars Paul Newman and Robert Redford, won the Oscar for Best Picture of 1973. Acting prizes went to Save the Tiger's Jack Lemmon, despite Jason's attitude, The Touch of Class's Glenda Jackson, The Paper Chase's John Houseman, and Paper Moon's Tatum O'Neill, still the youngest competitive winner in Oscar history.
Nice.
It's wild when you're like, oh, shit, she really deserved it. Because you sort of hear that and you're like, oh, it was a gimme or it was some sort of a, you know, no. Okay. The Sting came in second at the domestic box office behind William Friedkin's The Exorcist, which also topped worldwide grosses.
Brian,
a lot of Catholics in them days.
Sting and Exorcist, where do we land on those?
I'm a big fan of both.
Yeah.
Like them a lot.
Yeah.
But the big box office story of 73 was the Kung Fu craze. With Five Fingers of Death, an unexpected commercial smash upon its American release by Warner Brothers in March, followed by the domestic releases of Bruce Lee's The Big Boss, incorrectly retitled Fists of Fury, and Angela Mao's Lady Whirlwind, retitled Deep Thrust.
Huh. Ouch.
I wonder why they did that.
Yeah, I wonder. Yeah.
I wonder where that came from.
Uh-huh.
On May 16th, those films held the top three slots on Variety's weekly box office list.
Like, that is nuts.
Top three.
Were imported kung fu movies. That's how ready people were for kung fu movies in 73.
Crazy.
And then came the release of Enter the Dragon on July 26, less than a week after the untimely death of its star Bruce Lee. Was that the first, let's get these tickets, because I know people do that now, like somebody dies and like all of a sudden their records all of a sudden they're selling records on iTunes and they've got a new compilation
I guess, like, that technically makes Enter the Dragon the first Bruceploitation movie, although it wasn't made to be
Fair point. Wow,
fair point.
Nah, these were big film reels. It took them more than a week to ship that shit around and get them printed and everything, right?
That's very happenstance. True. Yes.
Or did Bruce do it on purpose? Sorry. Enough Bruce Lee speculation.
Yes.
Enter the Dragon would go on to become the second highest grossing movie of 1973 worldwide with an astonishing $400 million in gross.
Woo! Shit.
That's insane.
In 73, money.
I know. That's what I'm thinking. Wow.
August 17th saw the release of Westworld, which would feature a total of 2.5 minutes of pixelated images to represent an android's point of view. Super cool. Have you seen that?
Yes.
This was the first ever instance of digital image processing in a major motion picture.
Congratulations to the future CGI makers of the world.
It's like, it's way more awesome when you sort of understand that.
Mm-hmm.
And porno chic was still a thing in 1973. Cue the disco music. Yay. No, this is too early for disco music, isn't it? With The Devil and Miss Jones coming in at number 10 on the year-end top 10 with $15 million in official accounted for rental.
Which means you know it made like... 6 times that much, and the mafia just took all the rest.
That's a good movie. Yeah. Have you seen it yet?
I still haven't seen it.
Me neither.
Oh, really? It's a good movie. Yeah, it's a good movie.
I'm sure.
The Pure Cinema guys would like Devil and Miss Jones. And in film books, Pauline Kael published Deeper Into Movies. Peter Bogdanovich published Pieces of Time. And maybe most importantly, really, Kim Jong-il published On the Art of Cinema. And that is your Hollywood Minute.
Wow.
I would just like to make it known that all film critics are following in the footsteps of Kim Jong-il. All right?
Wow, rude. Really rude, Mike. A really mean thing to say to me. Brian Saur, you ready to do a lightning round?
Let's do it.
Okay, 5 minutes on the big clock. You know how it goes. Yay or nay or thoughts or pass. And here we go. Oh, Lucky Man.
Love it. One of my favorite soundtracks of the 70s. Great, great music.
The Outfit.
Fantastic. Absolutely one of the great crime films of the 70s and a great, great Joe Don Baker performance.
Oh, hell yes.
Role. So good.
Hell yes. Emperor of the North.
Another one that just about made my list. Aldrich. Two guys, hobos on a train, could pair with Scarecrow in some ways. great performance by Lee Marvin in that one, and a young Keith Carradine. I really like it. Oh, and of course Ernest Borgnine is a guy who loves to kill hobos. He's pretty pretty evil in this movie.
The Last American Hero.
Great. Another one that just about made the list. Jeff Bridges goes from moonshine running to stock car racing. And he's fantastic in it. Underrated movie, great supporting cast, including Gary Busey and Ed Lauder and William Smith and Diane Cannon again. I think Diane Cannon.
Damn.
No, I think she's in it. Yeah, I can't remember who the lady is. But great movie. Really, really good stuff.
Don Siegel's Charlie Varick, newly streaming on Netflix, much to my shock.
No way. Did not know that. That's fantastic. Another one that was just inches from being on the list. Fantastic Walter Matthau performance. Another great Joe Don Baker performance, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And Andy Robinson from Dirty Harry is really good in this. Guy trying to dodge the mob after accidentally stealing their money from a mob bank. It's just really, really good. One of Siegel's best movies for me.
Agreed. Slither.
This one is from Howard Zeef, and this one is a personal favorite of mine, almost made the list as well. James Caan ends up on sort of a road journey to get a bunch of money from his a guy he was in prison with, played by Richard B. Schull, who's a really great character actor who didn't get enough press. And he comes across like Sally Kellerman and Peter Boyle, and it's just a wacky, weird movie. I really like Zeef. Zeef did Hearts of the West, which is another great Jeff Bridges
movie.
Oh,
so good.
That's a good one. So he's underappreciated. He also did one called House Calls with Walter Matthau, which I just discovered last year and loved. So he's just a director nobody talks about anymore, and I like him a lot. So good stuff.
Fantastic Planet.
One of my favorite animated films ever. Very trippy, but still very relevant. If you see the movie, you'll know what I'm talking about. Good stuff.
Paper Moon.
I should have put that on the list probably, but that's one I feel like more people are aware of. I think that's why I went with some of these others. But yeah, I mean, one of Bogdanovich's best efforts, RIP Ryan O'Neill, easily one of his best that he ever did. And like Mike said, Tatum really earned it. You know, she is so, so good in this movie. Great black and white. I love that he was shooting in black and white in the 70s.
Friends of Eddie Coyle.
Love it. Love it. great, great Robert Mitchum, crime film, Peter Yates. It's a fantastic movie. Good stuff.
Terrence Malick's Badlands.
Another that should probably have been on the list. You know, Malick's first movie, and what a way to start it off. I mean, incredibly dark, sort of Bonnie and Clyde story, but still incredibly funny too. It's nuts. Great film.
Electra Glide in Blue.
Fantastic motorcycle cop movie with Robert Blake. I love it. I absolutely love it.
Messiah of Evil.
This one's gotten a little more love. Last year got a nice Blu-ray from Radiance, which is, I definitely
great
recommend
Blu-ray. Yeah.
People picking it up. Really, this is one Elric turned me on to, as I'd seen it, but I didn't appreciate it until Elric really made me more aware of it. Just an incredible mood and atmosphere. Great, great horror movie from the early 70s. Really good stuff.
Juvenile Court.
This one I just watched, actually, as research for this episode.
This is a Wiseman, right?
Yeah, Wiseman. Frederick Wiseman is one of my favorite filmmakers, you know, period, but definitely one of the great documentarians of all time. And by the way, all his films, I tout it all the time, but all his films are, almost all of them are on Canopy, and you can watch him there, which is an incredible luxury if you had ever tried to find his films, you know, 10 plus 15 years ago. So this one is really, really good. Just really powerful stuff, dealing with a lot of young kids getting in trouble with the law. And it's that, you know, great fly on the wall observational filmmaking from Wiseman. I absolutely love it.
Jeremy.
Beautiful coming of age love story. Got to shout out my friend Jonathan Hertzberg and Fun City Editions, put out a great Blu-ray of this. Robbie Benson and Glynis O'Connor, truly heartbreaking, truly wonderful together. Love it.
And finally, just because I never resist an opportunity to say this title, Lolly Madonna XXX.
That's a good one too. I like that one a lot. I feel like Ed Lauder's in that one, and
yep,
and Rod Steiger, and yeah, really good. Really like it.
This is one that I only knew about because of Elric talking about it on your show, and then I caught a 35 millimeter screening of it up here in New York.
Nice.
The Nighthawk Cinema does the Deuce film series, which I try to go to whenever I can, and they had a battered, pretty fucking red 35 millimeter print of Lolly Madonna XXX, and that was like the right way to see that movie.
Nice.
All right. Excellent lightning round, Brian. Nailed it as expected. Where can people follow you on social media and such?
I am Bob Freelander on Twitter and Blue Sky and Rupert Pupkin Speaks on Instagram. And, you know, we have the Pure Cinema Pod, Twitter, Instagram, Just the Disc Pod, Twitter and Instagram. That's my basic stuff. We also have a Facebook group, Pure Cinema Movie Club. People can go and join if they're interested in that. But those are the big ones, you know. And then, of course, the podcast feeds, wherever you get podcasts, you can listen to Pure Cinema or Just the Disc.
Yeah. And you should know, we should plug too. You guys just launched like a new website for Pure Cinema, right?
That's right. PureCinemaPod.com, I think. I apologies. It's so new. I barely remember.
we will definitely, we'll link it either way. And of course,
Pure you guys Cinema also podcast.
There you go. Sorry. And you guys also have a great page on Letterboxd if you're not following them there, where they got lots of stuff.
Oh yeah, I'm on
as
Letterboxd
well.
As well. Follow me on Letterboxd if you're into that sort of stuff. I'm a you know, obsessive Letterboxd
yes.
addict.
Yes. I am Fun City Cinema on Instagram, Jason-Bailey on Blue Sky and the aforementioned Letterboxd, where you can find under my list the top fives for every episode of the show. Mike, where can people find you?
I am Brainwashed Lib on Twitter and Fifth Column Films on Blue Sky.
And of course, if you like the show and think other people might like it too, please leave us a rating and or a review on your podcatcher of choice. There are just so damn many movie podcasts out there, so your recommendations really do help us out a lot. Mike, before we go, what is your parting recommendation for 1973?
Okay, so 1973, everybody's seen The Long Goodbye. I'm just going to assume... Mm-hmm. that everybody's yes. seen The Long Goodbye. And if you haven't,
yes.
just start there first. Okay, there you go. You got your, right? You even got your
yep.
shirt on. Now,
yep.
Good man.
If you've seen The Long Goodbye, then next up you should go watch Big Zapper, which is it's a very softcore, although somewhat adult, take on the character, where it's a female who plays the detective, and her boyfriend slash assistant, his name is Rock Hard. It's that level of comedy, but it's like, we're sort of deep enough into the Marlowe thing at that point that the Long Goodbye is recognized as a sort of anti-take on the character, right? As a, I mean, that's the sort of conversation you always have. Yes. We always have about it. Right. Okay.
Right.
Big Zapper is that, only not nearly as intellectual, but it is, it is a great, fun movie. There's some boobs in it. Like I say, it's soft. It's not anything too crazy. You know, sometimes you'll see it sort of listed in some lists along with, like, Devil and Miss Jones or some of the other, you know, movies you definitely don't want to watch, like, with your mom, maybe not even your girlfriend, you know, that kind of thing, right? Big Zapper you can put on a part at a party, and as long as most of the people there have seen Long Goodbye, they will enjoy it. That's my recommendation for 73. How about you, buddy?
I want to take this opportunity to send out, this is one that Mike and I saw together on a double bill at Film Forum when they did a big New York in the 70s retro, which was huge research for the book, but a film that I think you're a fan of as well, Brian, that's Cops and Robbers, which is a terrific movie about a couple of dissatisfied New York City cops who are watching the city go to shit and know they can't do anything about it. So they decide that they are uniquely equipped to steal a bunch of money from a Wall Street firm, and they go about doing exactly that. It's just a lot of fun. It is a really well-executed, that just sort of, like, you know, kind of loose-limbed 70s urban comedy thing. It's, you know, it's not quite as dark as A Little Murders, but it's in the same ballpark. And the performances in it are a lot of fun, and it has a really, really satisfying ending. This is one that was sort of an unknown. I only saw it because we went to that double feature, Mike, but since then it got a really nice Kale Studio Classics Blu-ray, and I would highly recommend picking that one up, even on blind buy, because it is a fun and funny picture. All right, thank you again for coming on the show, Brian.
A couple of comedies. Look at us hitting the end of the show with a couple of 1973 comedies.
There we go.
Nice. That's good. That was like some good powdered sugar on top of the pie. I liked it.
Love it. There we go. Thank you so much, Brian.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Jason.
And thank you for listening. Sweet and clear.
It was a very good year.